Hi, I'm Barbara Eisenstein, and I'm here with you for the Theodore Payne Native Plant Tour 2020 during the coronavirus catastrophe, I guess I'd say, pandemic. So we're doing a virtual tour, and I'm making a video for the first time with my husband, thank you, Jim, holding the camera. Anyway, here we are in Garden 28 in South Pasadena. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about my garden and what we've tried to do here over the years. And then we're going to walk around the front yard a little bit. After a while, we'll take you into other parts of the yard, the backyard, a side yard, and try to give you a sense and a feeling for the garden since you're unable to be with me. Okay, here we are in the front of the yard. Just to give you a sense of where we are, we're in South Pasadena. We're on a very busy street. And I've planted a lot of wildflowers and other things that bloom quite a bit during the springtime, as you can see. So they're all along the sidewalk. People get to see the monkey flowers that I have planted. Those are the orange ones. There's a little bit of penstemons and just all kinds of things that burst into bloom at this time of the year. So this whitish gray bush with the beautiful yellow flowers is Palmer's Senecio. It's about 5, maybe 6 years old, and it does look wonderful at this time of the year, very bright and really kind of pops. As we move towards the front door, I have deer grass growing, and then some more monkey flowers and verbena. So all kinds of different flowering plants. At this time of the year, the structure of the garden doesn't show off very much because so many things are in bloom. There are so many annual wildflowers and the monkey flowers, all these colors. But later in the year, when everything quiets down, across the front of the yard, I have a drift of deer grass. The idea was to have these large bunch grasses sort of providing structure and organization to what right now is sort of a cacophony of wonderful colors and textures. But I love the grasses, and I love the way they blow in the wind. And speaking of wind, it is a very windy day. There's traffic going by, so I hope you all are hearing me well. But the motion and the movement of everything in the garden is just another thing that's just very enjoyable. Here we are in the front of the house. As you can see, there's a path that goes straight up the center of the house. The house is a two-story Craftsman that was built in 1910, and it has a wonderful symmetry to it. We wanted to accentuate the symmetry, and so we planted two manzanitas on either side of the path. This really draws people into the house up to the big oak front door, and is just a very welcoming feature. So here's one of the manzanitas. It's Arctostaphylos manzanita. So over time, it's going to get larger and larger. It'll probably, hopefully, if it makes it that long, be 7 or 8 feet tall. And the bark of it is that cinnamon brown, which goes really nicely with the paint colors of the house itself. So there's one on either side of the front entranceway. We're standing in the front yard now. We put in, gosh, just last year, these flagstone paths and patios. And we installed them as a way to be able to use the front yard, to be able to interact with the landscape, not to be standing on the outside edge of it, but rather to be able to walk into it and enjoy it. So you're surrounded by all of the plantings. There are deer grass that run along. They're in the front part of the garden, and they run as a kind of wave across the front yard. And they cut across the front main path, sort of from east to west, going straight across. As I mentioned before, when the wildflowers aren't here, they show up more. So they give it structure and meaning, and you know, the kind of repetition is comforting to the eye, along with the motion that you get from these kinds of bunch grasses. But right now, we have tons of wildflowers. We have clarkias and phacelias, poppies, of course. There is some nasturtium as well, which I allow to stay in the garden. They're non-native, and they are kind of weedy and invasive, but they're oh so pretty. Over on the left side, you can see there's a little vegetable garden that we've installed. We put the vegetable garden in after we lost an old avocado tree. This is one of the first full sun gardens. It's not really full sun, but it gets a lot of sun, that I've ever had. So it's exciting to me to be able to put in some vegetables, grow tomatoes, lettuce. Right now I have a whole bunch of garlic growing in there and onions. In this portion of the front yard, I've planted David's Choice Artemisia. That's the soft gray plant. And so what I'm after here, what I was trying to do is sort of intermingle plantings that are grasses. We have some juncus, and the wildflowers are coming and going. And so there are some shrubs. So it gives you a lot of texture. It's kind of interesting. Kind of a tapestry is what I was going for. The larger plants that you see, the coarser ones with the dark green leaves, those are just annual sunflowers. And they come and go as they will, where they will. This year we're going to have fewer than we've had in the past, but it's a wonderful plant to have if you like goldfinches, because they really enjoy eating the sunflower seeds. Here we are now on the side of our house. This little garden, it's a little shady garden. Again, we have a good bit of shade in our yard. I call this garden the secret garden. The reason I call it that is because I got that name from my daughter when she was a little girl. It's a very private little garden. It's a small space. It's contained with a fence around it, and it has these toyons along the edge. And I just mentioned a minute ago that my daughter called it the secret garden. She used to set up tea parties back here. And you do feel like you're kind of away from things, even though we live on a very busy street with a lot of traffic. Back here you feel a little bit private, and it's just a comfortable feeling. So we planted toyons along the edge of the fence to screen the yard from all of the traffic and hustle and bustle out on the street. And they have done just that. In addition to that, they now at this time of year still have their red berries on it. The berries appear around November or December, so we have them for months. They're quite ripe, and I believe that I just saw a cedar waxwing enjoying these berries, because they love toyon berries. So I'm going to talk about a few of the plants that we have back here in the secret garden. One is the toyon, which puts on these red berries and gives us really beautiful color in the winter when there isn't a lot of color. Right next to me over here is a bush called fuchsia flowering gooseberry. It's not a fuchsia, but the flowers look a little bit like a fuchsia. It is a gooseberry, which means it's a currant or a gooseberry ribes, but it has thorns on it. It drops its leaves as soon as it gets hot and dry. So usually around June, that thing drops all of its leaves, at which point I do some pretty severe cutting. That shrub, what it wants to do is really just be a big rambling thing, and I don't want to let it get out of control in this space. So it drops its leaves, I cut it way back. Then as soon as we get some rain, it leafs out. The leaves are beautiful shiny leaves, and then the flowers form, and right now the flowers are just about to go into gooseberries. Which again, lots of animals love. The flowers are particularly attractive to hummingbirds. We get a lot of hummingbirds in those flowers. A shady garden, like I mentioned here, and you can see on my other side down here, I have a ground cover of snowberry, Symphorocarpus, I believe that is. And that forms a really nice understory for this area. It also will lose its leaves. I don't water this garden hardly at all. Maybe a couple of times a summer I water this, that's all. So they will drop their leaves when it gets very dry. I just want to point out this little path. It's a little patio, a little sitting area, flagstones, very natural, allowing as much infiltration as possible. I want to tell you a little bit about the backyard. It's quite different from the front yard. the backyard here is quite shady, so we don't have a whole lot of flowers. I know what you're thinking. There's a shrub behind me with plenty of flowers, but most of the year there are really very, very few flowering plants in the backyard. And the reason for that is that the backyard is shady, which is wonderful in the summer. It keeps it cool. We have two old, very mature avocado trees, and we have one Coast Live Oak, which was a volunteer. It's probably pushing 100 years old at this point. I say a volunteer, and what I mean by that is that it wasn't planted intentionally. It just grew, and the people who were living here before us decided to leave it be. So we're very proud of the Coast Live Oak. It's a real asset in the backyard, in our whole landscape. So what is behind me that is blooming at this time of year? Every year, right around the time of the Theodore Payne Garden Tour, this bush, which is a flannel bush, bursts into bloom. It's actually a little bit late this year because the weather this year was, we got these late cold rains. It was just a very weird winter, but it bursts into bloom. So it is Fremontodendron. It's probably a cultivar. It may be golden, not golden abundance, California Glory, but then again, it may not be. It was mislabeled when I bought it. It's a beautiful shrub, but it's an interesting shrub. One of the things about this plant is that it really does not like summer water. This plant has to be dry in the summer or it will die. So years ago, we had a lot of lawn back in here, and this was a much smaller plant. And as it started to grow, I started to remove more and more of the lawn. Just like in the front yard, we now have no more lawn. And the Fremontodendron is very, very happy. I'm going to call it flannel bush. So it's a beautiful shrub, bursts into bloom at this time of year, and it will continue to bloom throughout the summer. Not so many flowers, just a few popping here and there on it. It gets covered with bees, so that at certain times you just hear the humming of the bees. So I love that very much. My grandkids are not as fond of this plant, and I want to tell you about this. Flannel bush has something called stellate hairs on it. You can see I'm standing a little bit away from it. Those hairs get stuck in your skin. Doesn't bother me so much because my skin's a little tough and rough, but for little kids, that's kind of objectionable, and it drops its leaves and they have all these hairs. So if you're considering getting one of these plants and putting it in your yard, I think it's a wonderful plant, but you just have to remember, number one, it gets big, as you can see. Number two, it does not want to have any summer water. So it'll grow beautifully for a while if it gets summer water, and then it'll up and die very quickly. And number three, it has those stellate hairs. So if you have lawn and you plan to be running around in your bare feet, this is not your baby. You don't want to have that. So the rest of the backyard, all I want to say about it, I wanted to feature the flannel bush. All I wanted to say is that over the years, I have surreptitiously and sometimes right out in the open removed lawn, and now all of the leaves from the various trees, the oak tree, the avocados, even the flannel bush, are allowed to remain on the property. I do not remove any. And as a consequence, we have gotten a huge number of birds, lizards. I'm sure we have other little rodents and things like that here. We have tons of squirrels, too many. But they're all enjoying the yard as well. And that's something that's very important to me. The garden is a place of comfort, a place we enjoy being. I hope you can hear some of the birds. They're in the trees. But it's also habitat, and it's important to me. That's why I use native plants. That's why I don't clean up the leaves. That's why my garden at times looks a little messy. It's because it's for me, it's for my family, it's for my guests, and it's for all of the birds and other animals that come and join us in our backyard. I wish you could have been here with me in my garden, but hope that you've enjoyed the 2020 Theodore Payne Virtual Native Plant Garden Tour. You can learn more about my garden and the journey from lawn to wild suburbia
on my website, weedingwildsuburbia.com, and my book, Wild Suburbia, Learning to Garden with Native Plants. In the meantime, spend time out in nature. But for now, please, stay safe, stay healthy, and stay home.